Hello, my name's Seymour Stoll, and I started collecting baseball cards when I was a little boy. I was 8 years old.
It wasn't easy being a modern Orthodox Jew in the 50s and early 60s in Los Angeles, especially for us going to parochial school. You know, and going to school was no problem with the neighborhood kids. We got there because our hours were much earlier than theirs. Depending on what grade you were on, you got to school 7:30, 8 o'clock in the morning. So that wasn't a problem. But coming home was the problem because we had a double curriculum. Half the day was English, half the day was Hebrew. And on the way home, it would be 5:30, and the neighborhood kids who weren't Jewish would be waiting for us down our blocks to try to beat us up because we were Jewish. And if you weren't fast and nimble, and you would get beaten up almost on a daily basis. Thank God I was pretty quick and I escaped and I got home alive and well. But a lot of people weren't so lucky and they got beaten up every day. When Sandy Koufax made his announcement that he was Jewish and that he wouldn't play on Yom Kippur, all of the Los Angeles community stood up and listened, and he commanded all of their attention. I mean, everybody knew who Sandy Koufax was. I mean, unless you lived in a cave living in Los Angeles, you always heard about Sandy Koufax. You saw him on television, you heard about him on the radio, you read about him in the newspapers. So when he said something, people really listened. And when he decided not to play, everybody saw the Jew in a different light. They weren't the 98-pound weakling that you could throw sand at and beat up. They became strong and powerful and virile and athletic. They became doers. And you could see immediately the change in the kids in the area, too. The kids that tried to beat us up all of a sudden said, hey, you know, Sandy Koufax, he's Jewish, so if you guys are Jewish and he's a Jew, and they idolized him, then maybe you got here, you're okay, you know? So instead of trying to run after us and chase us and hit us, et cetera, they came up, they said, you know what, maybe we weren't friends, you know, before, but, you know, Koufax is a Jew, you're a Jew, let's bury the hatchet, you know, let's be friends, let's play. And that's exactly what happened. We started playing with each other, there was no more problems. For a little kid, that's a big deal. And so it really transformed in a very positive way the way that we lived. And this was because of his simple action of refusing to play on Yom Kippur for the World Series, for the first game.
When I was 14, I got a card of Sandy Koufax, and I showed it to my father, and he told me, that's really great, but why don't you get a card of every Jewish player who ever played in the major leagues? And I sort of laughed, and I said, well, this will be pretty easy. It'll take me a couple weeks, a month, 2 months tops. And little did I realize it would take me 45 years to finish up the collection. I did it because I loved it and never thought it would be worth anything. But I wanted to get the story of the Jew in baseball and how it integrated us into society out there to other people that didn't really know the story of the anti-Semitism, the adversity, as well as the success and the victories that we had since the beginnings of baseball to the 21st century. And there's a concept in Judaism called Achdut, or Achdus, depending on which persuasion you belong to. It means unity. And baseball unifies us none other than any other sport that's out there, better than football, more than basketball, tennis, you name it. Baseball unites us all, young and old, men and women, boys and girls, and that's what it's all about. It teaches us about ourselves and it teaches us about our lives, that we're Jewish, we're American, we love baseball, and this unites us all and makes us much stronger. And that's the reason that I wanted to make this collection complete and spread the word with everybody else as well. That's what it's all about.
Seymour, thank you so much for having me.
How are you? It's a pleasure to have you here. I just want you to know that I saw your documentary on HBO regarding Marty Glickman, and I thought it was really, really fantastic.
Thank you.
If you could just explain to the people out there a little bit about that so we have a context of what we're going to be doing here today.
Marty Glickman, for those who don't know, was one of two Jewish runners who was not allowed to run for the U.S. Olympic team in Berlin in 1936 because we were placating Adolf Hitler, and Hitler didn't want to see Jews on the victory stand. Marty went on to become beloved and revolutionary pioneer of sports broadcasting for the New York Knicks, and later the New York Giants and the New York Jets, and then mentored some of the most famous broadcasters today, most among them Marv Albert, right, and Bob Costas. And, you know, he knew some of these people. He knew Hank Greenberg very well. They were very good friends. And he knew Sandy Koufax the tiniest bit, not that much. Because Marty used to do the pre- and post-game shows,
right,
for the New York Yankees and Brooklyn Dodgers.
Right.
And he was actually given a chance to do the play-by-play for the New York Giants baseball team, and turned it down because he had just bought a house and they couldn't give him enough money that he would have to leave a job. He couldn't take, you know, the cut in salary. But, you know, I'm coming from a point of view of, you know, I also collected cards as a kid, and my brother and father and I always talk about great Jewish athletes. And so this is a real kick for me to see your collection, and I appreciate it.
Thank you very much. So we'll give just a brief history of,
sure,
of baseball. As you know, the Hall of Fame, the Baseball Museum in Cooperstown, was dedicated in 1939.
Right.
And the reason they did that was because it was the centennial anniversary of baseball from 1839. Abner Doubleday, at the time they thought, invented baseball.
I don't know.
Of course, we know that that's not true now, because in 1791, some of the counties in Massachusetts actually enacted some laws. They said baseball can't be played within 80 yards of any municipal building because they were afraid that the windows would get knocked out.
So
I don't know what type of baseball they played back then, or even if it resembled the game we know today, but we're already going back into the late 1700s. So, the laws of baseball that we're most familiar with today came from the New York Knickerbocker baseball team in 1845. And the first amateur game recorded in history was in 1846. The New York Knickerbocker baseball team played the New York Nine, and they played your back east guy. They played in Hoboken, New Jersey, in Elysian Fields. That was the first amateur game between two teams. Now, the first professional team came along 23 years later, was the famous 1869 Cincinnati Red team.
Right.
All paid professionals, and you know, you get what you pay for, and they went undefeated the entire season. In fact, if you take the last eight games of the previous season and part of the 1870 season, they won 89-0. 89 consecutive wins. They finally lost in 1870 to a team called the Brooklyn Atlantics. And they said it was the greatest baseball game that was ever played. They lost in extra innings 8-7. And this is where we're going to start our history of the Jews in Major League.
Okay.
So the first Jew who ever played was a man called Lip Pike. He was a member of that 1870s Brooklyn team that beat the Cincinnati Redlegs.
And how do they know that was the first Jew that ever played versus someone played a few years earlier? How would they know that?
They have records that have him as the first Jew who played versus others we'll talk about that came around a little bit later. But it's a good question because actually Lipman Pike was the first paid professional player in Major League history in 1866.
Leave it to a Jewish athlete to be the first thing.
Even before the Cincinnati Reds, he was the first person to be paid by his team, and they paid him $20 a week to play baseball.
That's a lot of money back then.
That was a lot of money back then, 1866. The reason they did it is because he had everything. He was the real deal. He was a five-tool player, as they say. He could hit for power, he could hit for average, he could field, run, and throw. And he was so fast that his team arranged a race between him and a horse to see who could make it around the bases faster, and he beat the horse.
Oh, my God.
So he was the first player to win the home run crown in 1871.
How many home runs? I'm guessing it's like around 10 at that stage before the...
It was the dead ball era, and he hit four home runs.
Four home runs,
and everybody, you know, snickers, and they smile, and say, so big deal, he hit four home runs, but they don't realize that entire teams didn't even hit that much. The ball was bigger, and it was so heavy, it took a Herculean strength to hit one out of there. So in 1871, there was a league, it was called the National Association of Baseball Professionals. They preceded the National League, which began in 1876.
Right,
so for those 5 years, that was really the first professional baseball league in the United States. And he had a tremendous career. When the National Association folded, he went into the National League. And in 1877, he won the home run crown again,
wow,
hitting four with the Cincinnati Reds. He was so good that 55 years later, after he had passed away, and most of the people that saw him play had also passed away, when the inaugural class to be inducted into the Baseball Hall of Fame was chosen, he received votes to get into the Baseball Hall of Fame. That's how great,
wow,
he was. He was named one of the five greatest baseball players in the 19th century. And he just was an all-around player who just had all the tools. So
would anyone else who was named to that five best 19th century, would any of them be names anyone would remember or
not? Oh yeah, you have...
to put him in context.
Sure, you have Cap Anson, who
okay,
had over
yes,
3,000 hits.
Yes.
You had a lot of members of the Cincinnati Reds, Cal McVay. You had other members of different teams that are in the Baseball Hall of Fame. So a lot of the people that were in the National Association transferred over,
gotcha,
to the National League when it began in 1876. Now, Lip Pike doesn't have a card. They never made a card of him, unfortunately, during his playing career, which is why we don't have anything on here. He does, however, have a very limited edition postcard made of him in his 1874 Hartford's uniform, which is currently on display with the rest of my collection in the Philadelphia, the National Museum of American Jewish History.
Okay.
And if I could just give them a plug just for 1 second, this is the first time in the United States that the museum has dedicated an entire exhibition to the integration and the history of the Jews in baseball from the early times of the 19th century through the 20th century and into our time, and how we integrate into American society. Then it's gonna tour nationally, and then there's going to be a panel version made of the cards,
yes,
and it's gonna be displayed at every single Major League Baseball stadium in the United States and Canada,
wow,
and it's gonna be distributed out to different libraries, historical societies, community centers and synagogues.
So you must be very proud. How old were you when you started first collecting a Jewish baseball card?
Well, in cards in general, I was 8.
Right.
When I first started the collection at the urging of my father, I was 14.
Mm-hmm.
So it took me 45 years from that time. It was tough back then. There was no internet. There were no cell phones. There were no answering service. I mean, everything that I had to do, either it had to be by telephone, by correspondence, or going to a show, a baseball card show, and try to, you know, collect the cards. It was tough. You know, everybody knows Sandy Koufax and Hank Greenberg.
Yes.
But they don't know anybody else.
That's right.
And the superstar cards, obviously, are easier to get than people that are so obscure that,
sure,
they might not have even had a card. So it took a long time, but thank God I did it.
Can you take us through,
sure,
this wonderful collection?
Well, at the same time that Lip Pike was playing, there was another gentleman who was playing also in the National Association, and his name was Levi Meyerly. Now, his nickname was Long Levi Meyerly because at the time, he was a tall guy. He was 6'1½".
Right.
Back in the day, that was,
sure,
pretty tall.
Sure.
He was a fantastic player himself. He was also named one of the five greatest players of the 19th century.
Right.
The 1871 Philadelphia Athletics were the very first professional championship team. He was on that team, and he played a tremendous role on that team because he won the first ever batting championship.
What did he hit?
He hit .492, which is an all-time professional major league record, either minor or major league, and it's never been even come close to,
wow,
since.
Wow.
.492. He also won the first.
So if he went 2 for 5, his average decreased.
Exactly. And he tied for the home run crown that year with our friend Lip Pike. He hit four home runs. And what really makes him famous is that he is in a tintype card, if you could call it that, from 1867, which I'd like to show you now.
Show us that, because people may not know what a tintype card is.
Okay.
I didn't know until you.
This is in a geometric thermoplastic case,
yes,
original, from 1867. And you open it up, and you have a picture of him playing for his 1867 Geary Baseball Club of Philadelphia uniform.
Look at that.
And there are only two examples of this tintype in existence in the world today. We're lucky to have this one here with us today. The other one, believe it or not, is in the Royal Museum of London, England. So you're going to ask me, what are the English doing with this tintype? And the answer is that many English historians claim that baseball evolved from the English game of rounders. Mm-hmm. And the Royal Museum supposedly has the second biggest vintage American baseball card collection in the world. And they had a phenomenally wildly successful show on baseball cards 2 years ago. And this was one of the crown jewels of their collection.
Very cool.
So like just two in the world, and it's just fantastic. And just for people that think that it's crazy or child's play to collect cards, this was appraised a couple of years ago at $300,000.
Okay, could you put that down right over there?
So that is our story with Levi Meyer. Now, we have a caveat here. We have a small problem. There are approximately, out of the tens of thousands of people that have played baseball, 165 are known Jews without any question. There are 14 players who I put in the doubtful Jewish category. Mm-hmm. Some experts claim that they are Jewish, some experts claim that they're not.
Let me ask you this.
Yes.
Is it simply based on the player's mother was Jewish?
No. I did this collection on the mother or the father.
Yes, because I know there are many Jewish baseball players today that I think Ian Kinsler is one.
Correct.
There are a bunch of them. Sean Green was one with the Dodgers and Mets. Or Ike Davis is one.
Correct.
Where one parent is Jewish. They might not have even necessarily been raised Jewish, but they would have been allowed to play for the Israeli team.
And they did.
Yes, for the Olympic team.
Yes.
And so that's what I was going to ask you about.
Yeah,
so it's either parent.
Either parent.
No matter how they were raised.
Exactly.
That counts. Okay.
Exactly.
Okay.
So there
so
are...
So 14 that are questionable. It's questionable whether the parents were Jewish.
Correct.
Gotcha.
And there are many historical societies and encyclopedias and other periodicals that will say, yes, this person was Jewish. No, we don't think this person is Jewish. I've done a lot of extensive research, Encyclopedia of Jews in Sports, a Jewish Almanac and Directory, many historical societies, scholars, the Jewish Virtual Museum. They all claim that Long Levi Meyerly, or Levi Shmuel, as I like to call him, was Jewish. Other people say, no, his burial records show. Not that they really get into
it.
See. But even if there is a doubt, I have them in the collection. This also, by the way, was on Ken Burns' seminal baseball series, Baseball, on PBS.
Yes.
So they used this as one of the cards, one of the tintypes for early baseball.
Seymour, let me ask you this.
Yes.
Is it my friends and my imagination, or it feels like there's a renaissance of Jewish baseball players right now? I don't know if it's because they're higher profile, like Ryan Braun or Kevin Euclid, Gabe Kapler when he played, Ike Davis. Is that true, or the numbers are still what the numbers have always been, or are there more Jewish baseball players in the last 15 years than there normally have been?
There are more today. There were more players at a time in the past, but nobody knew they were Jewish because they encountered such terrible anti-Semitism. They couldn't declare that they were Jewish because they would be blackballed out of the game. They would never be given a chance.
Right.
So, for example, you have...
Is this before when blacks were not allowed to play
baseball? Yes, we're talking about already in the early 1900s.
Gotcha.
In the first decade of the 1900s, we go back, there was a player called Phil Cooney, and he played one game for the 1905 New York Highlanders. They were the precursors of the New York Yankees.
Oh.
And he had one card. It was the 1911 OBAC series. It was a little tobacco cigarette card that you found in the cigarette packs and pulled out. People are paying thousands of dollars to get this card if they can find it. Not because he had no hits and only played one game for the Highlanders. It's because Phil Cooney was really Phil Cohen.
Oh.
People aren't paying thousands of dollars to buy a card of a player called Sammy Bone, whose cards, I have two cards here in two different colors, from 1922. His last name was B-O-H-N-E, but he really wasn't Sammy Bone. He was also Sammy Cohen.
That's so great. Well, it was in my film Glickman, Mal Allen's real name.
Right.
Was, you remember?
Israel.
That's right. And I never knew that as a kid. I didn't understand that Mal Allen was a Jewish broadcaster. It didn't exist. He was just a Yankee broadcaster.
Yeah.
So same thing with Sammy Cohen.
Harry Kane was Harry Cohen.
Right.
Reuben Ewing was Reuben Cohen.
Everyone
was a Cohen. You know who the very first Cohen who actually really
said used he was Cohen?
He was said Cohen? Right here. Andy Cohen.
Andy Cohen.
Andy Cohen was the first Jewish superstar in New York.
Wow.
He played in 1926, 28, and 29.
Look at this.
Now, John,
big league chewing
big league
gum.
This,
isn't that great?
This is his 1933 Gowdy chewing gum card.
And what would something like that be worth?
Today it's in the hundreds of dollars, probably $600-$700.
Right. That's great.
He was a phenomenally talented athlete, and you know John McGraw was the Hall of Fame manager for 30-something years for the New York Giants.
Yes.
And he was always looking for a Jewish superstar player to play because he wanted to satisfy the hunger of all the Jewish fans.
Yeah.
So he came across Andy Cohen. Now, Andy Cohen was so good that he did something phenomenal. He traded away Rogers Hornsby,
really?
Who was his second baseman. Now, for those that don't know, Rogers Hornsby was the greatest second baseman in the history of baseball.
Where was he in his career when he was traded? Early, late?
He was in the middle of his career,
really?
Because this was in the 1920s.
So Roger Hornsby was a superstar.
He had just won the Triple Crown. He was
was traded away for
Andy Cohen.
Wow.
For Andy Cohen.
I didn't know that.
And Andy Cohen had such a tremendous first game that the crowd stormed the field. They lifted him up, carried him away on his shoulders. He had a short but brilliant career. What happened was in his fourth year, he slid into second base, fractured his ankle, and of course medicine wasn't what it is today. That was the end of his major league career, but he played many, many years in the minors and had a cup of coffee as a manager in the majors. Just a thing as an aside that's really, really interesting. He was so famous, Andy Cohen, and so well loved that the New York Giants started selling at the Polo Grounds, which was their home, ice cream Cohens. You get it? Ice cream Cohens?
That's right over my head.
That's how ice cream started to be sold at many Major League Baseball stadiums because of Andy Cohen, a Jew.
That's great. Tell me, of the cards that are on the table, what was the most difficult for you to get of these cards?
Oh, boy.
Roughly.
Some of them, this card from Jim Levy. It's the 1933 Tattoo Orbit series card.
Look how small it is.
It's his only card that he ever had, and it's the only year that this company made baseball cards. It took me like 13, 14 years to get this card.
Wow.
James Levy was famous not just because he was a good shortstop for the St. Louis Browns, which were a horrible team, but he was a good shortstop. Before Bo Jackson, who was a famous two-way player, James Levy was also a two-way player. During the season, he played for the St. Louis Browns, and the off-season, he played for the Pittsburgh Steelers.
So he's a two-sport athlete.
As a two-sport athlete. And in those days, he didn't make a lot of money.
Not right.
So you had to...
So when you, Seymour, when you say that it took 14 years to get the card, what does that entail? Does that entail you knew the card was out there and just couldn't find it, or... And you're just calling people?
Exactly. In eating my kishkas out doing
it. And who finally had it that you got?
Somebody that I knew through networking in Minnesota. I think I know now every dealer and manufacturer and private collector all over the world.
And they know you?
Yeah. Here's a card from Cuba. It's Max Rosenfield, and it's in Spanish. And as you can see, it says Manager del Miami Beach. And in the back, everything, all of his statistics, everything else is in Spanish. It's the Propagandas Mundial Los Reyes del Deporte baseball card.
What year?
This is 1946, and this is his only baseball card. He was going to be the equivalent of the Brooklyn Dodgers superstar that they found. And he had three pretty good years, but they had other people come up and...
So these were cards by a Spanish company in Florida?
In Cuba.
In Cuba.
It was made in Cuba, in Havana.
So did they do the whole major leagues?
They did the
for
whole...
For the Cuban fans?
Correct.
Because they're very big baseball fans.
Absolutely. That's why they came out with these cards. And these cards are so thin that most of them just disintegrated. There's like none of them left. In this series, besides Max Rosenfeld, you have Babe Ruth, Ted Williams, Stan Musial, and a writer came over to me one day. He says, I don't get it. I just took a look at the prices for the cards in this series, and Max Rosenfeld is selling it a multiple of 5-6 times of Babe Ruth. Why is that? You can't find him. It's his only card. All the Jewish collectors want him. You can't go to Cuba to get him.
Is so, there a lot of competition with other collectors of Jewish baseball cards?
There was a ton of competition, which is why I'm glad I started all the way back then. Because these cards, you just can't find them anymore. Once they get into a private collection,
yes,
they don't come out for another 50, 75, 100 years.
They don't, but do they go to museums or people don't even put them on display?
They don't put them on display, and to be frank, most people just, even the collectors, they don't have most of the cards that we have here.
Right.
This is another interesting card. This is from the Federal League. The Federal League...
I've heard of the Federal League, but I don't know what it was.
They were formed in 1914 and 1915.
Yes.
This is a card of Benny Koff. He was called the Ty Cobb of the Feds because he was so good, he led the league in hits and runs and steals and batting average, you name it, he did it. So this is one of the few cards that's actually from the Federal League. This is a Cracker Jack card, you know, buy me some peanuts and Cracker Jacks. So Cracker Jacks would have baseball cards in their Cracker Jack package for 1914 and 1915. And so this is very rare, just even to have a card from the Federal League. And the reason they formed the Federal League is because of, in those days, as you know, you were a slave to your team. Once they owned you, you couldn't run out your contract and say, now I want to do that. You know, they paid you what they wanted to pay. And
up until the late 60s, early 70s.
Marvin Miller came in. Right, and the Messersmith case in the mid-70s changed everything with free agency.
Yeah.
So this was a fantastic find. And there's another card. It's the same Cracker Jack series of Erskine Mayer. And Erskine Mayer was the first Jew to have consecutive 20 win seasons. You know, if you ask that question, you know, they're all going to say it's Sandy Koufax. But he preceded him by like 50 years.
Wow.
And his teammate was Grover Cleveland Alexander, who's in the Hall of Fame. They went to the World Series in 1915. Anyway, getting back to Benny Koff, some people claim that his name was Benny Kaufman. But after the Black Sox threw the World Series in 1919, Judge Landis became commissioner, and he was going to crack down on everybody.
Right.
So not necessarily just gambling. So he kicked out the 8 players from the Chicago White Sox for gambling. And in 1920, he banned Benny Koff for life from playing baseball because he supposedly was, I believe he said, cavorting with unsavory characters detrimental to the name of baseball.
And did that have anything to do with him being Jewish, or that was simply he was cavorting with possible gamblers or whatever?
It could have been a combination of both.
Okay.
But things were sort of tough for Jews in those days. Even those days, a lot of people were hiding their names.
Absolutely.
And not letting anybody know that they were Jewish. There's a player here. His name is Barney Pelty. I have him in a couple of cards here because he was in a lot of the series of the day. He was on the worst team in the major leagues, the St. Louis Browns.
St. Louis Browns,
they were always bad.
They
Every year they were just
right.
bad, 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 except they had one good year in 1944. They won the pennant, and they played the St. Louis Cardinals, and of course they lost the World Series, but at least they had one year. Barney Pelty let everybody know that he was Jewish, and his nickname, in fact, even back then in 1909, was the Yiddish Curver.
That's great.
And the St. Louis Browns, as you know, became the Baltimore Orioles of today. And even today, Barney Pelty holds the all-time record for the lowest lifetime ERA of the franchise and the lowest single-season ERA for their franchise.
Let's jump ahead for a second because
I can't.
Growing up in New York, I was a Met fan, a little bit of a Yankee fan when I was really young. You have Elliot Maddox. Is he the only Elliot Maddox converted to Judaism?
Correct.
Now, what about Rod Carew?
Rod Carew...
He didn't convert, right?
Never converted.
His wife was Jewish.
His wife was Jewish.
So he doesn't count.
He doesn't count. Got I mean, I have his card, but I don't...
Just to be on the same side. That suddenly counts, you
have but I don't have him in the counting in the collection.
Is Elliot Maddox the only African-American Jewish ball player in your collection?
Yes.
Okay.
He's the only African-American who converted to Judaism. Now, okay. Ruben Amaro Jr.
Yes.
also converted to Judaism, but I believe he's Dominican.
Yes. So, can I ask you some questions?
Sure, absolutely.
I see Ken Holtzman. Ken Holtzman grew up in University City in St. Louis. I went to Washington University in St. Louis and lived in University City when it was not the best neighborhood in the world. I think it was nicer when he was there. And tell us a little bit about Ken Holtzman, and also he had a very contentious relationship with Charlie Finley, as many other people did, the owner of the Oakland A's.
Right. Ken Holtzman was really a superstar, as you know, growing up early, everybody knew he was going to be big.
Yes.
And he started his career with, not with the A's, but with the Chicago Cubs.
Right.
And one year he went 9-0, he was undefeated, and he also threw a no-hitter for the Cubs, as you remember.
Yeah.
And then the Cubs were in transition, and they decided to trade him to the Oakland A's, which was very fortunate for him because at that time the Oakland A's were about to start their dynasty run of many, many pennants in a row. And he became a multiple 20-game winner. But as you mentioned, he had a very contentious, as did most of the players on the team, with the owner, Charlie Finley.
Yes.
And he decided to leave and make more money, and he did as a New York Yankee. And he, by the way, has the most wins of any Jewish pitcher in Major League Baseball with 174 wins. The Koufax is 161.
Everyone would say Koufax, but Sandy didn't get to pitch for many years.
Right.
And as long as we're talking about Sandy Koufax,
yes.
A couple of things. It's long been maintained by certainly Sandy Koufax. He came up and he was a bonus baby. He actually took Tommy Lasorda's spot on the roster. And he was forced on the team when Walter Alston was the manager. And Sandy Koufax would pitch a great game, and Walter Alston, who there were some claims he was not the friendliest person to our people, would sit Koufax for several weeks and then pitch him again. He'd be wild. And Sandy always maintained if he had, I think about half of his career, he was not that effective. And then the last 6 years, he was the dominant pitcher everyone remembered. But he feels... if Walter Alston had just put him in the rotation and let him pitch, he would have been able to, become more dominant much faster. Because that 8 years might have been 4 years, and he never got that opportunity.
You're correct. In fact, most of the historians and documentaries will tell you that Walter Alston wasn't really that enamored with Koufax because he was a bonus baby.
Right.
Everybody hated the bonus baby then because that meant that you couldn't be sent to the minor
leagues.
You had to stay with your major league team. So he didn't trust him, and he didn't like him to begin with, and he wasn't that enamored that he was Jewish.
Yes.
So he would use him, but just like you said, he'd have a great game, then he'd sit for 6 weeks, and he'd come back out. So by the time he became a superstar, like you say, this could have happened much, much, much earlier. Other stories also say that it was Norm Sherry, one spring training, told Sandy Koufax, look, you don't have to pitch so hard, so fast, because he threw 100 miles
and
an hour.
Jewish, and he was Sherry, Jewish, and his brother Larry Sherry was a catcher, but he was also Jewish.
Exactly, so they had a lot of Jews on the Dodgers at that time.
Now, I bet you know this story, but there's a very famous story about Sandy Koufax did not pitch the first game of the 1965, was it?
Correct.
World Series against the Minnesota Twins.
Right.
And Don Drysdale pitched. And Don Drysdale got bombed, and Walter Alston came out to the mound and to take the ball from Drysdale. And Drysdale turned to Alston, he says, I bet you wish I was Jewish today, too.
Yeah, it's a very famous story. There's another famous story with Don Drysdale and Sandy Koufax. You know, the Dodgers in those days, they were a dominant team, but their offense was really
good. They didn't score much.
So what would happen is Maury Wills would walk.
Yes.
He'd steal second.
Right.
He'd go to third on a ground ball from Jim Gillian, and he'd score on a sacrifice.
Correct.
The game would end 1-0.
Yes.
Now, in those days, and they do it today as well, if you were pitching in an away game, the team would send you out to the city that they were going to go to, so you would have rest.
That's right.
So Don Drysdale was scheduled to pitch the next day in Pittsburgh. So he was already in Pittsburgh. So somebody came up to him and they said, Don, Mr. Drysdale, Sandy Koufax just pitched a no-hitter. He says, did he win?
That's true. I'll tell you, I had one conversation with Sandy Koufax. I wanted to do a documentary on Sandy Koufax. Larry King, who's in the film I did, Glickman, is friends with him, and he put me in touch, and they sent him my film, and I didn't hear back from him for about 6 months. And then one day, I get a call, and he goes, hello, this is Sandy Koufax. I very calmly said, oh my God, I can't believe it's you. And he said, I have no interest in being in a documentary because he's so intensely private.
Right.
And I respected his privacy, but I told my friends it was the greatest rejection phone call I ever got in my life. Sandy Koufax personally called me to tell me, don't make a documentary about me.
You know, there's another thing while we're talking about him, I just want to get this in because this is so great.
Well, he is, for people who knew nothing about Jews and baseball, the vast majority of the public could tell you Sandy Koufax was a Jewish baseball player.
Right. And he was such a dominant pitcher and would just blow everybody away with his fastball that...
Great curve, too.
Yeah,
he had two pitches.
Yeah. Willie Stargell, who's a Hall of Famer himself,
yes.
He said, hitting against Sandy Koufax is like drinking soup with a fork.
Yes.
So I think that pretty much says it all about him. And also Casey Stengel, the old professor from the New York Yankees, he was in baseball almost 70 years.
Yes.
70 years, his entire life. They asked him, they said, who's the greatest pitcher who ever pitched in Major League Baseball? He said, let me tell you something. He says, I'm 80-something years old now. He says, I've seen everybody. I've seen them all. I've seen Rube Waddell. I've seen Walter Johnson. I've seen Grover Cleveland Alexander. I managed Whitey Ford. He said, the Jewish kid is the best of them all.
They were in the 63 World Series when Koufax struck out 15 Yankees. Mickey Mantle batted... Roger Maris batted in front of Mickey Mantle, and Maris struck out and came back, and Mickey Mantle was in the on-deck circle about to come up. He said, what can you tell me? He said, I can't tell you anything. I didn't see anything. I didn't see one pitch he threw.
Yeah. By the way, just before we get off of Koufax, he won the Most Valuable Player Award in 63, and he won 3 Cy Young Awards.
When it was only awarded
that's
to one pitcher, not both leagues didn't have it.
That's what I wanted to say.
Yeah,
you're right. In that time, there was only one Cy Young for the National and American
League. Right.
And those 3 years, he still won the Cy Young Award.
That's right. I'm going to go now to this card. I have a small trivia question. I was a big fan of the Mets, and when they won in 1969, I was always very proud. Art Shamsky, who platooned in right field with Ron Swoboda, was Jewish, and everyone in New York knew it. So here's my question for you. What did Art Shamsky hit for the 69 Mets? What was his batting average for the 69? That's a tough one. If you know this, I'll be stunned.
I'm going to tell you in a second. And it was 300 exactly.
It was the only time in his career he hit 300, and he did it that championship year.
So he really helped propel them that year to the championship,
yes.
Which is good. You know, you have, just while we're at it, Maury Arnovich,
yes.
Who played for Philadelphia and Brooklyn, he kept kosher on the road.
Oh, man. That's
and, you
tough
know,
to
if
do.
It's hard today when you go to some of these cities, you can imagine how hard it was for Maury Arnovich. And he was a great player, too. He had like a 287, 288 lifetime batting average. He was third in 1939 in the National League. They gave him his own day at the park. He was very, very proud of his Judaism, and which is the opposite of another player. It's sort of a funny story that Norm Miller, who played for the Houston Astros, wasn't so religious. In fact, he was totally irreligious.
Right.
And he played on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, the Jewish New Year and the Day of Atonement. So on Rosh Hashanah, he struck out 4 times in a row. And in Yom Kippur, he played, he hit in like 2 double plays and struck out the other time. So he said to his manager, I'm never playing on another Jewish holiday again. Period. That's it.
That's it. I did not know, I had heard of Lefty Phillips, the manager of the Angels. I didn't know he was Jewish.
He was Jewish. In fact, he was one of the few Angel managers at that time in the early 70s that was successful. And he unfortunately passed away, had a heart attack. And that's why most people, you know, never heard of him. He only managed the Angels for 2.5 years, but he was very successful. And then the person who followed him was Norm Sherry, who also was Jewish.
Yes, who we just talked about.
Yes.
So here's Mo Berg,
okay.
Which The Catcher Was a Spy. It was a famous book about Mo Berg.
Right.
Morris Berg. And tell the people who don't know about him about Mo Berg.
Well, this is his 1939 play ball card. Moberg had a long career in the major leagues, about 16, 17 years, and he was a linguist. He spoke 7, 8, 9, 10 different languages. He was very, very intelligent, college educated, had his college degree, which is very rare for a ball player in those days.
Yes, very rare.
And what happened was, this was in the late 30s, early 40s, and as you know, the United States sent their best baseball players every year to Japan to play in an exhibition series against the Japanese, because the Japanese were very baseball crazy and had their own major leagues.
Right.
So the people who would go to these exhibitions would be Babe Ruth and Lou Gehrig and all of the biggest of the big.
I have footage of the 56 Yankees or whatever going to the Japanese game.
And Mo Berg was a member of this team. So everybody said, well, what's going on here? I can understand these other players, but why Mo Berg? I mean, you know, he's an educated guy, but he's not in the same class athletically as any of these other people.
Right.
And as it turned out, he was a spy for the OSS, which was the precursor of the CIA.
Yes.
And they wanted him to take pictures. He would pretend he was a tourist with the baseball team and climb the tallest buildings in Tokyo and take pictures of everything and give them to the U.S. For intelligence. He also went to Europe, where they were about to develop the atom bomb.
Right.
And he was given the assignment to kill the scientist who was developing the atom bomb if he felt from his lecture that he attended that he was close enough to do it. It would have been a suicide mission. He was in the first row, he would have shot him and taken a cyanide pill, but they determined that they weren't close enough, so he didn't have to go that far. But he worked for the OSS for many, many years, and only after he passed away did people realize that he was also a spy besides a Major League Baseball player.
That's great. Now, I'm looking around.
How about the first designated hitter in baseball history?
That was what I wanted to talk to you about. I know this because I was in New York, and Ron Bloomberg was a Yankee. And here's my other trivia question.
Yes.
It's about the only two Jewish trivia questions I know. Art Shamsky, just because I watched all those games.
Uh-huh.
The other was Ron Bloomberg. He was the first DH in Major League history. What did he do in that at-bat?
He walked.
With the bases loaded at Fenway Park to drive in a run. Excellent. Seymour, I'm very impressed.
Oh, thank you very much. And then he hit a single afterwards also. He just beat Orlando Cepeda, who
was
the second person at bat.
See, I knew once I started speaking to you. I didn't know that. That's Ron Bloomberg.
Ron Bloomberg, 1973.
Isn't Zimmerman the, I see here you have
Jordan Zimmerman. Yes.
But that's not that's Washington?
Yes.
But the third baseman.
No, that's Ryan Zimmerman. Now, there's a doubt.
That's what I was going to ask.
Yeah, that's why
I heard he's Jewish.
I heard that also. I'm not sure. I'm doing my research.
My friend Amir Kepner, who did a documentary on Hank Greenberg, claims he's Jewish.
Okay, good. Well, I have his card anyway, just in case.
You got an extra ride for Ruth?
Yes, I do. Yes, I do.
You ready?
I'm ready. There's another trivia question. While we're around, we might as well. I put them both together. In 1951, was the first time that a Jewish pitcher, catcher, and hitter faced each other all at the same time. So who are the three people?
I wouldn't know 1951.
So here we go. So we have Mo Ginsberg, who was the catcher for the Detroit Tigers.
Yes.
And Sol Rogovin.
Not Mo Berg, Mo
not
Ginsberg.
Mo Ginsberg, right. Correct. Sol Rogovin, who was then on the Tigers as well.
Yes.
And the hitter was Lou Limmer. And the umpire said, wow, this is, you know, this is, he even realizes this is the first time you have like three Jews at the same time at the plate.
I wonder how often that could have happened. I mean, with Norm Sherry and Larry Sherry, there'd have to be another Jewish ball player at bat, but
I wonder if that's happened since. I think it's only happened one other time, and that was the Boston Red Sox with
Gabe Kapler, Nucleus.
Ryan LaVarnway was the catcher.
Right.
And I think it was Craig Breslow was the pitcher.
What year was
and
this?
It was just a couple of years ago. So it's just the second time in history that something like that happened. By the way, Lou Limmer hit a home run in that at bat.
Is that right?
So it would have really been complete if the umpire was Jewish, and there were Jewish umpires, but not in that game.
So
umpires never had cards. Did
they? Did have cards.
Do you have any Jewish umpire cards?
Yes, I do.
Look who I'm asking.
Dolly Stark was a Jewish umpire.
Yes.
And he was in the 1955 Bowman television set series.
Yes.
And that's the only Jewish umpire that umped in the majors.
Right. We referenced him, but as long as we're Sandy Koufax, let's talk about Hank Greenberg.
Okay, so let's talk about Hank Greenberg. Of course, Hank Greenberg was a superstar.
Yes.
He was the biggest American Jewish superstar for decades and decades. He played for the Detroit Tigers his entire career until his last year when he
Pittsburgh
Pirates. And as his Hall of Fame plaque there shows, you know, he led the league in home runs 3-4 times. He had a lifetime batting average of .313. He was the most valuable player twice. And by the way, Hank Greenberg was the first most valuable player to ever win the award at two different positions.
He played first base.
Yeah. And then when the Tigers later on in his career acquired Rudy York, who was this lumbering first baseman who could hit for power, but he couldn't move. So they said, Hank, would you please do us a favor and move to the outfield? He said, sure. And then he won the most valuable player in the outfield as well. This card, by the way, it's the 1938 Gabby Heads Up series. It's a very expensive series. This card comes with the cartoons and without the cartoons. The ones with the cartoons are much more expensive.
Wow.
The reason that I chose this card to show today is because in 1938, Hank Greenberg hit 58 home runs.
Yes.
The record, of course, was at that time 60 by Babe
Ruth.
This is
what I was going to ask you to tell this story. I know what you're going to say.
In 1927.
Yes.
So what happened was the last 8-9 games of the year, none of the pitchers would give him anything good to hit.
Correct.
Because they didn't want a dirty Jew to play, you know, to play and have a chance to beat Babe Ruth's record.
Yes.
Now, Hank was very diplomatic. He always claimed that they pitched to him. It was just, that's how it was. His son said the same thing. But Charlie Gehringer, who was his Hall of Fame second baseman on his team, said there's no doubt in any player's mind, none, that they didn't pitch to him.
Yes.
And in fact, you'll appreciate this because you're a New Yorker there and you went to a lot of Mets games and everything. When I was doing my training in New York, I had a chance to meet Ralph Kiner.
Yes.
Who was a broadcaster for many, many, many decades for the New York Mets.
The Mets, and before that, people don't remember, was one of the greatest sluggers ever for these terrible Pittsburgh Pirate teams at Forbes Field. And Ralph Kiner was hitting 40-plus home runs when very few people were doing it.
That's right, and not only that, but he holds the all-time record. He won the home run crown his first 7 years in a
That's
row.
That's correct.
So he's also obviously
involved. And my father's accountant was Ralph Kiner's accountant.
There you go. There you go.
But just said the greatest guy in the world, just the nicest man.
Yes.
Everybody loved Ralph Kiner. He just passed away a few months ago.
So I got a chance to talk with Ralph Kiner one day at the ballpark, and I said to him, you know, I know that you were Hank Greenberg's roommate on his team for his last year in 1947. He says, I know what you're going to ask me. I said, well, I'm here. Let me, he says, I asked Hank Greenberg the same question. I wanted to know, did the pitchers pitch to you or not pitch to you because you were Jewish? And he said, Hank Greenberg told him they did not pitch to me. And Hank Greenberg, he was a superstar, but even he had a lot of adversity. There was a lot of, you know, you're talking about the rise of Nazism. You had Henry Ford, who was no friend of the Jews.
Well, he played in Detroit, which you also had...
Father Coughlin.
Yes, that's
who had one of the most vicious anti-Semitic radio shows.
Every Sunday.
It was the number one rated show in America,
yes.
And he blamed the world's problems on the Jew.
And he was this Jewish superstar playing for Detroit, and they said he probably did more to help the Jewish cause in that era, especially in the city of Detroit, than anything else. He also, by the way, was very friendly to Jackie Robinson when Jackie Robinson came up, because he had suffered, not what Jackie suffered, but he suffered a lot of
discrimination
coming up. Yeah, absolutely.
There was a play at first base where Hank Greenberg was then on the Pittsburgh Pirates and was Jackie Robinson's first year as well. They collided at first base, and Jackie Robinson fell down, and Hank Greenberg picked him up. He said, are you okay? You know, so they started talking about everything, and Jackie Robinson said that Hank Greenberg was the classiest guy he had ever met.
And to put that in context, the very fact that he touched Jackie Robinson. There's the famous story of Pee Wee Reese putting his arm around Jackie Robinson in public at second base.
He didn't do that in those days, and that was considered
so that Hank Greenberg helped him up. No one was helping. They were too busy knocking Jackie Robinson to the ground.
Hank Greenberg said every time he hit a home run, it was like he was hitting a home run against the Nazis. And, you know, just to show he was no wallflower, Hank Greenberg was 6'3½" and 215 pounds. The Chicago White Sox were one of the worst anti-Semitic teams in the league at that time, and they'd given him a terrible time this one game. They razzed him the whole game, and he wasn't going to let them get away with it. So right after the game, he went into their dugout, one man against 25, and he said, "Whoever called me those names, you come up and you tell it to me to my face right now." They said not one man spoke, not one man moved, because they knew that Hank Greenberg would have killed them if he...
Hank Greenberg was also a great athlete. He used to play tennis late into his life. He played against Marty Glickman. Marty told me the story that Hank Greenberg, he never beat him. Hank Greenberg was too good. He was a very competitive, great, great country club tennis player late in his life. He was just a magnificent athlete.
There's another thing about anti-Semitism you talk about, and you'll know about this guy, Al Rosen.
Yes.
Who almost won the Triple Crown. He missed by one point, winning the batting crown, home run crown, and RBI crown.
For people who don't know what the Triple Crown is, it's tell them.
Yeah, to win the home run crown, the runs batted in crown, and the batting average crown, all in the same year. He was very, very proud of his religion, and he was so proud he wanted to change his name from Al Rosen to Al Rosenstein, so that there was no doubt that he was Jewish.
He encountered,
of course, a lot of anti-Semitism in the South. And he said if somebody called him a name, he'd let it slide the first time, he'd let it slide the second time. But after that, he said, these people have to be taught a lesson. Mm-hmm. He said, and the only thing that the bully understands is a bigger bully. And after he gave them a beating, they never gave him a problem before. It's just sort of like Seymour Block, Cy Block. He had a cup of coffee in the major leagues during the 40s. And when he was in Arkansas, he had a terrible time against anti-Semitism. And one player in particular was really giving him a bad time. And that player made a base hit, and he was running towards second. And the ball came to Cy Block. And as they met at second base, he put his glove and the ball, and he mashed it into the guy's mouth. And he said the guy lost 6 teeth, he couldn't speak, and he never called him a Jew bastard again after that. So that took care of...
Probably never called anyone anything again with no teeth.
Well, here's an interesting thing, too, that we forgot about, I forgot about, I have to apologize. We talked about James Levy before.
Yes.
In the early 1930s, he was a shortstop. Also in the 1930s was a shortstop for the Cleveland Indians called Jonah Goldman. And this is the only time in baseball history that two Jewish shortstops played against each other.
Really?
Yeah. And James Levy was also very proud of his Judaism. This is the fellow we were talking to, was a two-way athlete. And there was a report showing that he was not Jewish. And he went to the Jewish press and he said, "I want you and the whole world to know that I'm Jewish and I'm proud of it."
Now here's a question. You said there were 165 Jewish ball players known. How many people in that time played Major League Baseball? Do you know that number? You're saying 165 in the history.
Total.
Do you know, have any ballpark figure, the total of all major leaguers?
I'm wondering how it is versus the percentage of
Jewish population.
Yeah, it's around 1% or less. There have been tens of thousands of total major league players who played in the major leagues.
It's not that far from the American Jewish population
in
the United States. It's pretty even.
Yes.
It's pretty representative.
Pretty representative.
Yes.
You have a card here, Harry the Horse Danning.
Yes.
He was an all-star catcher for John McGraw. Again, John McGraw was the manager that wanted to constantly get the Jewish superstar.
Yes.
And Harry the Horse Danning was an all-star catcher multiple times, played for the New York Giants, as did Harry Feldman, and as we talked about, Andy Cohen. And also, there was a gentleman called Phil Weintraub. His card isn't here, it's in the museum. But I have to tell you this story, if you'll allow
me.
Okay,
sure.
And like we were talking about before, it was tough before. The only way to get these people was to go out there, beat the ground.
Yes.
He was in a series, Phil Weintraub, who was the V355 1936 Canadian Gaudi series. It's all French in the back of the card, and it's a black and white picture of the person in the front of the card. For years and years and years, people thought that there were only 134 cards in that series. There were rumors that there was a card number 135, but nobody really could tell for sure. Finally, that card did emerge, and lo and behold, card number 135 was Phil Weintraub. Now, not only was it a rare card because it was short printed and hardly any of them ever got out there, but it took me, I don't know, 30-something years looking. And when I would go to these shows or ask somebody about these cards, they would laugh at me and say, "You're an idiot. What are you doing? I've never heard of these things." I went to one show, I think it was in Long Beach, and the very first table that I came to was a dealer from Canada. And he'd never been in the United States before. It was the first show he ever did. And I said, "Well, you're from Canada. I have this series. I know it's very, very rare. You probably don't have any cards here of it, but, you know, here it is." Mm-hmm. I says, "You know, I think I've heard of the series, and I have about three or four cards from that rare series here. Would you like to take a look?" I said, "Okay, but the three or four cards, you know, what?"
Yes.
The third card I saw, that was it. Card number 135 was Phil Weintraub. It's the only time in 45 years I've seen that card.
Wow.
And that card now goes for tens of thousands of dollars. I mean, you know, it was just there.
That's amazing. When did they first start selling cards the way we know, where you weren't getting it in a Cracker Jack's box, where they said, "There's value to this, people want to buy this"? What, do you know the year they started doing that?
Well, Topps, which had a monopoly on the cards
for years,
until 1981,
I know.
Right. They started in 1951, and up to today, they're still going.
Sure.
You have a lot of these, most of the other rare cards that we've seen here, the companies are long gone. You have a lot of the tobacco cigarette card companies that are long gone.
Now, the tobacco cigarette, they came with a pack of cigarettes,
right?
Or you couldn't buy them separately?
No, you couldn't buy them separately. You bought a pack of cigarettes, and you opened it up and pulled the card out.
When could you first buy a pack of cards? Do you know? I don't know.
Gowdy, in the 1930s, which was that Andy Cohen card.
Yes.
You could get in a box.
Yes.
Most of the time, you couldn't get any cards in a box. You either got them out of a vending machine,
right,
or a cigarette pack.
And were they packs in the vending machines, or literally one card?
One card would come out, and this was usually during the Depression.
So it probably cost a penny or something.
Yes, they cost a penny. They cost a penny at the time. And, you know, they were just so rare. A lot of these cards were regional cards. They weren't even put out. If you didn't go to the ball game, then you just didn't get it.
Was Topps the first company to put bubblegum in the cards?
I'm not 100% sure. I believe they are. Of course, it was hard as a rock. So if you tried to eat it, you'd break all your teeth off or something.
What's so funny is when I was a kid, that's what we all wanted, the cards, but we loved the bubblegum. And then when the cards became collectibles, the white powder of the gum were ruining the value of
the cards.
So then they took gum away, and then someone came back a few years ago and they put gum back in a cellophane, so
right,
it wouldn't,
so
it wouldn't ruin
the card.
Yes.
The vintage card market went crazy the last few years.
Yes.
And people are discovering that these cards just aren't out there, and the history is just so fantastic. You know, once you learn of it, it's unbelievable. It's like Mike Epstein. His nickname was Super Jew.
I remember that.
He was on the 1960 United States baseball team.
Did he played in Washington, didn't he play
yes.
for Ted Williams, when Ted Williams
mm-hmm.
was the manager?
And he was another, he ended up also playing for the Oakland A's with Ken Holtzman.
That's right.
So they had two Jews in Oakland.
This is
Ryan Braun.
This is a jersey card.
Yeah, this is a jersey card, a triple swatch jersey card and signature card. And just to show the difference how cards
yes.
are made today versus cards that were made in the old days.
Yes.
You also have, like we were talking about before, Kevin Youkilis.
Mm-hmm.
And this is his jersey card. Kevin Youkilis this year, by the way, is the second Jew ever to play in the Japanese leagues.
That's right, he went to Japan.
He went to Japan this
correct.
Year. And you know who the first was? Your
Gabe,
other friend,
Gabe Kapler.
He beat him by a year or two.
They played together
They played
in
together
Boston.
In Boston. And Gabe Kapler has tattooed on his ankle, never again, so that people, when they see him...
I thought Jews weren't allowed to have tattoos.
They're not. Maybe we'll give him a head tear. We'll
okay. And we're going to give him a pass on his baseball tattoo.
We'll give him a pass on his baseball tattoo there.
Tell me about this card. This is unusual. I've never seen a card quite like this.
This is from a newspaper periodical. It's called the M105 series card of Mel Wolfgang. And the newspaper would make their own baseball cards, not any type of company like we know today. And they would give it out if you
were... It looks like a newspaper.
Yeah, yeah. If you subscribe to their paper, then yes. Then you would get it. They would put it out
so
there.
So that has to be extremely rare.
Yeah, a lot of the times when I was... This is card number 194 in the series. Every time I would try to look for this card, and it took me years to find this card too, they would have card number 191, 192, 193, 195, 196, 194 always seemed to be missing.
You're always missing the Jewish
card. And of course I knew why it was missing, you know, nobody else knew why, but I finally, and they have the famous Gimbals.
Gimbals ad on the back.
Yeah. And Hank Greenberg married, one of his wives was the daughter of Gimbel.
Yes, correct.
So that was sort of a fun tidbit here. This card is from the 1890. It's Chief Roseman. It's called the Buckner Gold series.
Is this the oldest card you have, or you have cards predating 1890?
I have cards predating 1890.
What's the earliest card you have before you talk about?
1887.
Oh, so very close.
Yeah, very close. Yeah. But the tintype, of course, that we did was 1867.
Wow.
1867.
Go back and tell us about that card, please.
So this card was a 19th century card, obviously. It was a blank back. There was a lot of the cards in that, they had no writing in the back. It was just blank. That's how it's supposed to be.
People probably didn't even think of statistics as something someone would want to see.
In fact, that's a fantastic question, because the first card that ever showed anybody's baseball card statistics is... The T201 1911 NECA series and the T205
of course,
baseball
I knew
series.
That.
That's when baseball statistics started on the back of a person's card.
Wow, what year again? 1911.
1911. Wow. This player here, his father was an Orthodox rabbi, Mike Schemmer. Now, this is his only card. It's from the 1947 Sacramento Solons.
Sacramento Solons, they were a major league team?
No, they were a minor league
minor
team.
League.
This is the only card
got. But he did play major league ball.
He played major league ball in 1945 was the only year he played. Now, 45 was the last of the war years.
Yes.
So a lot of the players were in the service. They were overseas. And in 1945, Mike Schemmer played for the New York Giants. And he played pretty well. He hit .333, which is a really... good average.
But there's no card of him in the major league?
None. This is his only card, period, major or minor league
so
card.
So if you have a minor league card of a major league player who never played, does that have increased value, or people are not interested because it's a minor league?
No, it's even more, because this is the only card he had.
Wow.
Period. And the back is sort of funny. It's got sunbeam
that's
bread.
Great. That's
it's a baking series. Series. And this is from 1947.
That's great.
So, of course, when the war ended, Johnny Mize, who was a Hall of Famer, came back to the Giants and took his rightful place at first base. But this was a son of a rabbi playing baseball, you know. So
this has been great. Seymour, the tremendous collection, and so people understand this is just a small portion of his collection. So much of it is in Philadelphia.
I just have one more story to
tell. And tell me before you do.
Yes.
Who is your favorite card for any reason? What's the card you personally, got this card, it means so much to me.
It has to be the 1867.
Because this doesn't exist.
It doesn't exist. Yeah. I mean, it's even hard to describe what it is.
Yes.
You know, you tell somebody it's a tintype, how do you describe something like this?
I got it.
You know, but this is the best story of them all.
Okay.
We were talking about adversity, anti-Semitism in baseball. There was a player called Harry Chosen.
The perfect name for the Chosen people.
He was probably the best catcher that nobody in the world has ever heard of.
What year?
Well, the reason that you never heard of him is because he was only in the major leagues for 1 year, which was in 1937.
36.
The reason being, he was unfortunately the property of the Cincinnati Reds.
Yes.
Now, the Cincinnati Reds at that time were the most anti-Semitic team in the major leagues, and the board of directors and ownership boasted that no Jew would ever play for the Cincinnati Reds, ever. And they kept their word, And even though everybody knew that Harry Chosen was a great player, they would never let him up into the major leagues. One year, though, in 1937, he won the Most Valuable Player Award playing in El Dorado. And he led the league in practically every single offensive statistic. So when 1937 came around, they couldn't really keep him in the minor leagues anymore because it would have been such a blatant example of anti-Semitism, they had to bring him up. So they had a meeting with the board of directors. They said, we'll make an exception, we'll let him onto the team, but that doesn't mean we have to let him play. So in those days, the season was 154 games. Today it's 162, as we know, starting with 61 with Roger Maris. And that's why it has the asterisk by his name. The first 153 games, Harry Chosen sat on the bench and never moved. The only time he got out onto the field was for practice, and when he went onto the field, the fans of Cincinnati, which were very anti-Semitic at the time, they threw garbage at him, they spit on him, they called him names, and they threw rocks at him, everything. And it wasn't only in the stadium, because he couldn't sleep in the same hotel as his fellow teammates because he was a Jew.
Oh, this sounds...
And so you know what I'm going to say. I mean, he had to sleep on the park bench, or he couldn't even sleep on the team bus sometimes because the driver didn't want to sleep with a dirty Jew. And you know what the hotel sign said, right? The famous sign, no Jews, no Negroes, no dogs.
Right.
He couldn't eat at any restaurant because no restaurant would serve him because he was a Jew. And if they did serve him, they served him garbage. So this is what he had to endure. The final game of the year, I don't know what happened, was a miracle. He got into the game, and he got one hit and four at-bats.
250.
Right. Was pretty good. The season ended for the Reds. They sent him to the minors, never to be heard from again. And I felt really, really badly when I read this story, and I wanted to find out whatever happened to him. Mm-hmm. So 50 years later, after all of this happened, through my contacts and everything, I got a hold of him. I got his number. He was living in New Orleans at the time. He was in his 80s. And I told him, hi, I'm Seymour Stoll. I'm doing a collection of baseball cards, and I'm really interested in your story. Can you tell me the story? Is it all true? He says, everything that you read was true. He said, I was very, very disappointed how the Cincinnati organization treated me. And my career, you know, could have been so much more. But, you know, listen, that's how it was. He said, don't feel bad for me. I married a wonderful woman. I had a good family. I became a successful businessman. He says, but my family, as badly as I felt, they felt even worse. So they decided they were going to cheer me up because I never had a baseball card at all. So what are we holding here? His family decided they were going to make his own baseball card for
him. What year was this?
In the 1950s. Mm-hmm. So they made, just like Cops does today, they took his uniform, in the Cincinnati uniform, put his statistics on the back, and made a baseball card of him, you know, with his 1937, and they gave it just to their friends, close friends, and family members. And this was 50 years later. He said, you know, I know you have this big collection and everything. I might have one card left. Mm. Would you like it? I said, sure I would, you know. So he says, no problem, I'll send it to you. 2 weeks later, he sent it, and he signed it. Mm-hmm. So I was about to hang up the phone. He said, I don't want you to feel sorry for me. He says, I want you to know I got the last laugh. I got my revenge on everybody in Cincinnati that was an anti-Semite. I said, what happened? He said, well, in those days, of course, there was no television. Many people didn't have a radio. There was no baseball card, nothing. So the only way you could really connect with a baseball player in those days was to get a baseball and have every single person on the team sign it. And if it wasn't signed by every single person on the team, it was worthless. Well, nobody cared about me because he had never played before. He says, but now I was statistically significant. I had gotten a hit. Now every single person needed my signature for the ball to be complete. So all the people that I saw throw rocks at me and spit at me and wouldn't serve me, they said, oh, Mr. Chosen, I love you. You're my hero. You're my favorite player. Can you please sign my ball for me? So I said, so did you do it? And all I heard on the other end of the line was laughter. I didn't want to ask him whether he did or not, but you know, it's this is the card that never was,
so
never existed.
If he was such a great minor league baseball player, Cincinnati chose to send him to the minors and not sell him to another team that would play him.
Yeah, they just didn't
and get something for him rather than
they just didn't want a Jew in the major leagues. They didn't care. even if they would spite themselves.
Yeah, that's what that
because
is.
Because then they say, hey, we don't want a Jew playing in the major league, especially against us. We'll keep him in the minor league, so he just, you know, languishes there and never has a career.
Oh, that's terrible.
So, you know, you learn a little bit of the history and again, this is just a small portion of the collection, what the Jews had to go through, and really it's an amazing thing. I just wanted to finish, just so I know your time is very valuable and everything, but, you know, there's a concept in Judaism, it's achdut. Achdus, depending on what persuasion you're from, it means unity. And baseball, unlike any other sport, unites us. More than basketball, more than football, more than ice hockey, tennis, golf, whatever it is. I mean, it unites everybody. It's men and women, boys and girls, young and old. It's the story of ourselves. It teaches us about ourselves. We're Jewish, we're American, we love baseball. It unites us and it keeps us strong. And that's what this is all about.
That's a lovely sentiment and a great reason to collect cards. I mean, to have this collection. I can't thank you enough for
thank
giving
you.
Me
thank
your
you
time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you,
it's a Seymour. Pleasure.
Thank viewers.
Thank you.
I'll thank you on behalf of the viewers for showing us this wonderful card collection.